Okay, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Accelerator. I had a good lunch. You guys have a good lunch? What did you guys think?
Yes.
Pretty good. Not bad for a little hole in the road in Paragould, Arkansas. Let's get started again. We're going to just go. Last session, we talked about your top, that top bar that's on every page. And then we went over the dashboard and the widgets and kind of how those widgets could be used. Guys, there will be additional widgets that's something that is going to adapt as we go. There will be new widgets and you'll get a notification. Hey, new widget. Check this out. Use it or don't. If you don't use a widget, cool. If you do use a widget, cool. Right? You don't have to use every widget. You don't have to use any widget. You can use all of them. Doesn't matter. So moving forward, the next thing that I want to talk to you guys is I'm actually going to skip the My Day page because I want you guys to have a better understanding of the clients and leads sections, and then we'll talk about My Day. Calendar, this should be a really quick one. It's a calendar. Now, I will say that you've got your drag and drop events, right? So you can manage these. You can set yourself up if you do the same types of events all the time. If you do appointments or you do a certain type of thing that's always going to take a certain amount of time, you can set them up as like quick, drag and drop things. And then this is to put them in little, like this. And then you can just click save. And then now it's how they display. So you could put like consultations. And then you might have two or three different types of consultations. I don't know. I'm just telling you a reason why you could do that. Or you could delete them all out of there for all I care. Next, if you want to use one, you just grab it and you drag it on and it drops down. There's the 10th. When do you want it to end? Is it an all-day event or is it a timed event? What's the title? What's the content? That you just add an event. Now, you can also sync your Google Calendar. Both directions, right? Add an event in here and it goes on your Google Calendar. Add an event on your Google Calendar. It goes in here, all right? And that's per user. So if I want to sync my Google Calendar, it takes me over. I click, it says, do you want to let this happen? And now save. I've just synced a Google Calendar. That's how hard it is.
So if you do something over here, it's still synced.
If I build an event right here, it's in Stephanie's Google Calendar. If Stephanie puts an event on her Google Calendar, it's in here. Cool. If I come in here and edit it, it edits it on Google. If I go to Google and edit it, it edits it here. Cool?
Can you only sync it here?
Currently, right now, you can only do Google Calendar. iCalendar is coming. It's on the list. iCal is definitely on the list. Can't you sync your Gmail to your Outlook? Oh. That is something that we are creating. Yes, we're going to create a company-wide calendar. That's on the list. As of now, it's per user. We started with coming from the place of a user. Then we're going to step up to, okay, now what's something that I would want to see if I'm running, if I want to see everybody's calendar, or I want to see, the whole shebang. All right. But calendar, guys, pretty simple. If you want to add an event, you just click add event. It drops down. And then you can choose to add it or not add it to your Google Calendar right here. Definitely your Google Calendar right here. It's not my fault that Google makes it so easy to do. All right, so calendar. Any questions on calendar, guys? All right. Then let's go to, actually want to jump down and go to leads. So here's your lead list. When it opens up, it's going to default to like 15, I think. What is it? Maybe 10, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 10. It's going to default to 10. You have this little drop down here that you can list 15, 20, or all. If you click all, now you have your full list. Right? The reason for this is it's nice to fit right on a screen, whatever you want. You can set it to 5. It's right there. Now, it still goes and looks for all of the people, right? This is not the whole list. It's called pagination. So it's going to, or pagination, depending on who you talk to. But your whole list is still there. It's just like it would be like, all right, here's the next, and then the next, and then the next, and the next. Does that make sense, everybody? I just click next, 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 next. I can go through the list like that. But you notice that Susan is in here, right? And if I'm on page 1, there's no Susan. But if I search Susan, she still shows up. Does that make sense? That it's the list is there. It's just how much of the list you're viewing at one time. Does that make sense? You're about to zonk out. I see your eyes was closed. Oh, shake your head like this. Okay. All right. So your list is still there. So guys, the way that we kind of created this was it opens in line. So the idea is it's easy to go from one person to the next. Now you see it darks out the rest of the people. It's just a way to a nice, easy way for you to see who you're working on. Because if I've got my whole list here, and I scroll through here, and I want to open Nakia Mackey, and I click on it, it darkens out all the lower ones and the upper ones. Now those are still there, and they're still able to be clicked on. But it's just a not to that way you're not confused about who you're working on. So it's just right there. That's everything that you'll need. We have also moved to where a lead, guys, has every field that... now that I think about it, this was your fault too. Yeah, it's such a good thing. So we can all thank Katie that a lead now has every available field that a client has. Everyone. You might have a lead that hasn't really signed up yet that for some reason you want to create letters on. I don't know why, but Katie says
I just
no.
Wanted to upload the credit report without having to
go to the client. Yeah. So, but anyway, you can do everything on a lead that you can do with a client. Where do they fall? Do they land on the lead list or do they land on the client list? And, you know, your statuses would change based upon. If they're a lead, they can only have a lead status. If they're a client, they have to have a client status. That's really the only difference. But leads can have a progress tab. They can have notes. Did Karen leave? I need her. Oh, gotcha. Understood. Sort of. Got it. Nope. So this is your lead area. So when you open that up, you're going to have your quick buttons. Now remember, those quick buttons are the ones that you selected to show on leads. They're not the ones for client. They're not the ones for partner. These are the ones that you selected to show on leads. Did she talk to you out of that sweater?
No. I took it over because I'm hot and it's getting me.
Yeah. It's hot. Oh, I understand. I understand how boring this is after a good meal of delicious burritos and tacos. Yeah. And cheese. And salsa and chips. Yeah, I'm
We need to go swimming.
Yeah. I get it. So trust me. All right, so let's go through this. Your quick buttons, guys, if you don't have any, this will just be blank, and you'll still see the convert to client button. The convert to client button, does anybody want to guess what that does?
Convert them from a lead to a client.
All right.
And send them over to the client
section. Yeah, it sends them over to the client section.
Just one quick
step. Well, you click convert to client, and it says you're about to convert permanently in Nakia Mackey to client. Convert to client. You have to press the green button. Right? And so it gives you one time to say, you sure? Right? Okay. So down here, you have the ability to change a status. Now, we're going to talk a little bit when we get into the system settings of how to change statuses and then some of the cool things that you can do when you do that. But you can change a status just by clicking right here, and it's going to give you that sound. Bink. That's just you're about to change the status of Nakia Mackey from to test with sequence. There's a little error right there. On lead status update, it doesn't say what you're changing the status from. On lead status?
Yeah, hers actually does.
What does it say? Oh, no, I know what's going on. This person didn't have, if it doesn't have a status, it needs to say no status. Because this person didn't have a status. That's why it's not showing anything. So if on the lead status update notification, if they don't have a status, it needs to say no status. So you click continue. Now they have a status. So now if I try to change it, yeah, it still don't. Yeah, just we'll fix that. So that's how you change the status. It works. That's just telling you what status it's going from, so it's not like that's super important. But we'll make that happen. Then you got your little weather widget. You've got sunny, cloudy, rainy, you know, just an idea. It's going to be a little icon, a temperature. And then this is your edit button. This is where you edit all of this stuff. Down here, email. Guys, you can click email. It drops the email. You can send them a subject and a message. Also, you can select from your templates, right? So if I'm over here and I want to send this email, click. Then that's the email that it would send.
When you choose a template, will it put in a subject to what you choose, or do you have to write in the subject manually?
It's a good question. Currently, it appears that you have to write in the subject manually. If I have my way, which I get a lot, it will load the, I really need her back in here for notes or somebody. Well, I want it all in the same place. Yeah. You got it. Cause you were, I thought that's notepad she was already using. Great. Cool. When loading template email, load subject also, but it'll load it as an editable text area. So if you want to change the subject there, you can. Because one thing you cannot do is when you load this as a template, you can't then edit that.
Right, you have to go into the emails.
And right.
Edit the template.
Okay, so I built some of these out, but I couldn't find that bracket. Yeah, did you just manually put that in?
Oh, this right here?
Yeah, because I built some out, but I didn't want to say just like, hey, random person. I wanted to say their name. Like
right.
That.
We'll put it, we'll go over that when we do the email builder. I'll show you how all that works.
There?
Yep.
Cool.
Yep. So if you use a template, you can do that. If you do custom, it's just that. Cool. Cancel. Then you come over here. Let me edit this. They now have a phone number, and when I click their phone number, this is the message, send, this is the message, right? So I just got the text.
You can set it to come from a particular number that you want it to come from?
No, it comes from the DISCO short code, which is 69008.
Okay.
It's just going to come from 69008. Otherwise, everybody would have to go and set up their own profile, and then they'd have to do an integration, and then, like, it's a big deal. It comes from...
Just tell them the same.
Yeah. Sure.
I take all credit cards.
She doesn't even know what for. She's just like, yeah. Oh, wait, hold on. You know what? This meeting's over. There's a prince that's going to send me $16 million.
Yeah. Yeah.
We might as well shut this thing down. That's funny. All right. You know, I don't, I guess.
Does that come from that same short code?
Yeah, no, no, no. No, I was clearing out my emails. So, but they come out from 69008. So, that's what it comes from.
So you're saying they come from 69008,
but if you
want, you can integrate your own.
No,
no, no.
You're saying
it's
well, yeah.
Okay, I missed the part when you said, "Are you taking credit cards?" But I'm like, oh, so
to buy credit because it costs.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, we have to pay for these. Right? And while I'm cool with giving you guys the stuff that I don't pay for free, I can't step over into also paying for things. Well, I pay Maria currently about somewhere between $6 to $8 to $1,000 a week. So there's that. But I can't step into now paying for you guys to have your messaging. Even though I do pay for all of your emails to go out. So there's that. We originally were using our own email server, and then you guys just got too big, and then we were having trouble getting the emails to deliver. So now we use a third-party email sender, and the email, so every time you send an email, it costs me like a half a penny.
Can we integrate our own Mailweber with ours?
When you say integrate how?
Well, I mean, do we have all the emails that we send out that have to go through?
AWeber will accept a post, and you can send a post from Disco to AWeber to have it send anything you want.
Well, I don't know how that works, but I'm
gonna when we get into, guys, when we get into the campaign builder, you guys will see truly you can do anything nearly with Disco because it allows you to send a post. An HTTP post. It's hypertext transfer protocol. Do you guys need to know that? It just allows you to send it allows you to, through the URL, to send a string of code to another service, to another web service, and then that web service receives that code, and based upon, you know, what's in it, it tells that web service to do something. Technically, Disco integrates. Have you ever seen those softwares that say, we integrate with, and it just shows 1,000 things? Guys, I integrate with any software that'll receive a post. Any software. If it receives a post, Disco integrates to it. Most softwares will receive a post. So as long as you've got, you know, pretty much any other software, it'll integrate to. You just have to... The difference comes down to it being a built-in structured integration versus you telling it to send a post, which you would need to know what to tell, right? So, all right, little bit off here, but here we go. Disco has an API, limited currently, but it will increase and it'll get more and more functions of the system will be able to be done through API. I don't remember what it doesn't matter. So, like if I want to post a new client from another software, all that software would need to know is all of this stuff, right? So it would send a link, it would send a string of code with this and then all of this. It would send this string of code to Disco, and Disco would know how to read it, know where to put it, and then it can put in, you know, we can post a new lead, post a new affiliate, post update a client, post update a lead, post update an affiliate. You can add client tasks, you can add notes, you can create new opportunities and new opportunity stage changes. You can do all of that, but that's when you start getting into, you better have somebody on your team that knows what they're doing.
This is like for landing pages and things like that. Is that where this would come really?
This is how,
I mean, you could do like sponsored ads on Facebook. With
you,
this.
Yes, okay. You could. Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
Can you show us that when you do
this? I will not. I just won't because it's
really hard.
It's absolutely specific to every user. It has, there's no, I could show you how to do one thing and the minute you want to do something different, it's completely different. So, if you're going to be doing any type of integrations, get a programmer that knows how to do a integration with an HTTP post. And it's really like most, like you don't even have to have some great programmer. Pretty much any programmer knows how to create and receive and send a post. If they don't know how to do that, they're not a programmer. Right? They're probably a web designer, which are two completely different things. No matter what they say. When they say they're a programmer, and then they're like, I can program that for you. And then you're like, what are you going to use? And they say, well, WordPress. And then they can't. All right. So Authorize.net, we do a direct integration to. And Infusionsoft, we do a direct integration to. Now, when you're doing a direct integration with Infusionsoft, there's a lot of stuff to do. Like you're creating fields in Infusionsoft so that you can create a code of what you call a lead, because Disco is going to need to know whether that person in Infusionsoft is a lead or a client or whatever. They're going to need to know whether they're what they are to go get it. Once you've created that connection, you can they'll talk to each other. We do a cron job that runs, and they talk to each other. And then every time you load a client, it can run over and get that client's info. If you add a note, it can add the note to Infusionsoft. If you add a note in Infusionsoft, this can run in over and get the note. But you don't need to do that, okay? The vast majority of the things that the vast majority of companies are going to be doing, you don't need Infusionsoft with this. If you start getting really advanced in, you know, funnel marketing and stuff like that, then maybe you step into Infusionsoft. Or something else. There's lots of them. But it does have an integration there. But the biggest place to be for most of you guys, for anything that you're going to need, you just send a post. That's all you got to do. Just send a post. Cool? Send a post. It's easy. Okay. So let's go back to leads. We're actually going to go to clients. So let's say that now a client has been, or a lead has been converted into a client. Now we'll go through each of these tabs and show what they do. All right, so I'm on here. We did their email and the phone. You can save, do they have a website? Do they have an occupation? Do they have an income? Guys, stuff like that is really great for segmentation marketing. So you might want to say, you know what? I want to market to people who... This is a new product that I do, and I want to market to people who have more than this much income. I don't want to market this particular thing to people who make less than this. I want to market it to these other people. You can do that way. Billing status, joint customer. This one's pretty cool because it's a direct link. So her J. Marie's direct link customer is Bernard Tatum. If I click Bernard Tatum, it goes straight to Bernard Tatum's account. So if they're a joint customer. Now, the other thing that Disco does is it creates married invoices. So if you have joint customers, they can get a shared invoice. Now, it'll still show that this payment was for Bernard and this payment was for J. Marie and this payment, you know, this or this invoice item was for Bernard, this invoice item was for J. Marie, whatever. But they share that invoice because that's the way most people have preferred it. They don't like having this person's invoice and then this person's invoice and then they pay over here and then they pay over here. So it allows them to have one. Okie dokie. Monitoring site, username, copy, password, copy. These are click to copy. So you can click it, click. If the person had a monitoring site, let's actually give them one. Let's say that they're on ScoreSense. Now it shows ScoreSense right here. And if I click that, it takes me to ScoreSense. Now if I come back and I go copy, then it would copy their username. I can paste it. If I click copy, it copies their password and I can paste it. I know it's not a huge deal, but it is nice. It saves those typing in of the usernames and passwords. Just to save you that couple of seconds. Look, my processor back here is going, yes, that's a big deal. All right. You're going to have their date of birth and their social. You have the enroll date, cancel date, email opt-out, yes or no. Portal access, on or off. If somebody starts whatever and you're like, oh, yeah, off. Right? Their portal access, and make sure that they understand that portal access is part of their service fee. Make sure that they understand that. Because if they're not paying their service fee, cool. No portal access. Shut it off. Now, I feel like there's some time that goes, because if you shut it off, it's almost like, you know how we do with, on sometimes like cease and desist letters, you don't want to send one that says, don't call me or mail me or anything, because then their only option is to sue, right? So sometimes we say, well, listen, don't call, I'll talk to you by mail. That gives them at least a little bit of an option to have a communication. So it's kind of like the same with you. If you just shut them off, the likelihood of them paying nearly goes to zero, versus if you put them on, you know, you put them on a sequence that's maybe past due, and you're emailing them, hey, you know, at this date, if you've not caught up by this time, your portal's going to get shut off, whatever. Let them work to that. That's an advice that just comes from me. I don't care how you do it. Then you have the options to set their people. Now, this is something that's really, really important, and I really need everybody to really, really have an attention. Ready? If they don't have a partner assigned to them, or a processor, or a sales rep, or a customer service, or auditor, or billing, or owner, if they don't have one of those roles assigned to them, and you run a sequence step that sends an email from their auditor, that email will not go out. Right? Because who would I be sending it from?
Wait, do that one more time. I lost
you. Okay. So you're a new client. Okay. Right? And I don't assign you an auditor.
Okay.
Right? You're just floating around. You're not assigned to a particular auditor. And I assign you a customer service rep of Karen. But I didn't assign you, and this is all done. I'm going to show you guys how, based upon their plan, you can auto-assign everybody.
Okay.
Right? But if you don't assign somebody as an auditor, and then one of the sequence steps is to send an email from the auditor, that email is not going to go because they don't have an auditor. So who would I be sending it from, right? Okay, so that's one thing that's super important. Then you have your partners, basically your partner upline. So first level, second level, third level, fourth level, up to fourth level of affiliate. Cool? There are some new roles. There are some new roles that are going live that include affiliate manager and sales manager. So for some of you guys that have like, what? Okay. So what are you doing?
Adding a new client, and I had already used the email address.
I just got that too.
Change the email address, and it just says email already exists as a client. I won't let you.
It happened to a lead, and I was having to.
Yeah. Yeah. So.
But then I went back and it's in there three times now.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Why are you guys doing that? Okay. One thing that I have noticed is some of the buttons. This is definitely some of the buttons. When you click it, it doesn't disable the button. So you think it didn't work, and you'll click it, and then you click it, and every time you're clicking it, it's doing the thing, right? Yeah. Right. So anytime you see that, just let us know, because it's something that Maria didn't go through and when she was creating all the stuff. It wasn't. So if you back out of there, that client probably does exist. They don't?
Oh, okay. I see what it is. Because the first time that I did it, I put the email address and then it didn't go through. So then I tried doing it with, I just put no email lab, blah, 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 and then I go, and that's why I saw it.
Yeah. So wherever you see that happening, let me know, because we just have to, it's just a simple script that she built now that when you click the button, it disables the button for a second so that it can't be clicked again. But any issues, help desk. All right, so here's your thing. If you lower that, a little more room to work if you want. But this is your home tab. Moving next, we're going to go to progress tab. Progress tab has three sections: milestones, their overall, their deletion progress, and their score tracker. Milestones, you guys understand, you build those. You decide what your milestones are. That's one of the first things that we're going to do on Wednesday, is everybody's going to build their milestones. So maybe be thinking about that. You know, what do I want my milestones to be? You know, what are the main important parts of our service that we would like to see a visual representation of where that person is? Next is your overall progress. This tells you, you know, one of five has been partially repaired, one of six has been repaired, one of six has been deleted, and three of six are still negative. Now, you guys notice that we created a status called partially repaired. The idea behind that is, how many of you have ever had an item where a bunch of the late payments came off, but it still shows as negative, right? Everybody in here has had that. So now that doesn't take it off of the dispute process, but it does let that client know that something happened. It's really more about an understanding where your client goes, oh, so it shows partially repaired. What happened? Well, some of the lates, although it didn't go all the way to positive, this many of the late payments did come off. Isn't that better than them thinking nothing's happened? Right? You can choose to charge for a partial repair or not charge. We do not charge for a partial repair, but that's your company. Next is the score tracker. You can update scores two ways. You can either click the green button right there, or you can do it through the file review process. Okay? So, Katie, how do you update scores? How else?
Physically, how do we do it in the system, or like?
Yeah, I'm being a jerk, because you guys like working on other stuff. You'll miss it.
I'm trying to save a client, and it's not letting me.
Well, but go with us. We'll fix that. We'll fix that. Go with us, guys. I see a lot of like just clackety all over. Everybody working and stuff. If you're working on your business, I totally understand that we all have to run our business. But if you're like testing and playing with stuff, we've got 2 days to do all that. Let's get through some features here, because otherwise tomorrow I'll be like, well, update the scores, and then we'll have questions like, well, how? Right? Let's try to all stay together. You update the scores with this green button right here that says update scores. Right? Right here. This one. This one.
It automatically does it in the audit file review.
It automatically adds it in the audit and in the file review, and it adds it as the date of the file review that you do it. It'll automatically add the scores there as well. All right. Next is notes. There's really, all you can do is view and search notes. But you can also add a note. When you add a note, there's two options. You can either select a note category and template, right? If you do that, it automatically inserts a note. So you can create as many note templates as you want. You can create note categories, as many note categories as you want. To me, I see things like client notes, lead notes, partner notes, right? Just as a better way to keep them organized. But you select the category of the note, and then you select the template that you want to add. When you add it, it automatically fills out the rest of this stuff. You can set it to automatically add tags because of a note. Why would that come in handy? Here's my common example. It's one example that I'll give you, but it doesn't mean that that's the only reason. But imagine that somebody calls in and says, hey, I can't get into my portal. Can you give me my password? Right? Has anybody ever had, what's my password? All you do, you could set up a note template that says, client called and requested password. Save. You could set that note to automatically add a tag called requested password that would automatically send the email, sending them out their passwords and stuff, right? So you don't have to spend the 2 minutes to go send them the email. Because you added that note, it happened. Cool? All right. So if you do a lot of those little things like that, I promise you guys, you're going to feel, if you guys knew the amount of work that my team gets done, like they'll go, oh, I've got 123 tasks today, but they get them done, right? Worked on 100, you know, they get them all done. Because most of the tasks for a lot of these tasks are going to be 2 or 3 minute, you know, 1 minute things, 2 minute things, 3 minute things. Now you will have some that are longer, but I mean, Karen, how many of your tasks are 1 to 2 minutes long? Probably 80% of them. Because it's just do this one little thing. She's like, okay, did that, next. But that's the reason that she can get through, you know, 100 or 150 tasks in a day.
And that's because the one task triggers a bunch of other things.
Exactly. Yep, by marking a task as complete, that's just triggering out the next thing to happen. So we have some processes. So somebody comes in and they're ready for audit. Let's say they're ready for audit. Well, when their status goes to ready for audit, it sets a task to do the audit. When the auditor marks that task as complete, it changes their status to audit complete, sends them out an email, says, hey, your audit's now complete. It also sets a task for Tanya to go in and bill for that audit. Tanya, when she bills, she knows that at that point, it's either it cleared or it didn't. If it did clear, she goes to set for processing. If it didn't clear, they're failed payment. Right? If she sets it at set for processing, all she did was click set for processing. Yep. And then now the processor knows that it's cool to go in and start processing. They send the letters to the client. They set as letter sent. The system starts sending emails. Hey, don't forget to send those letters. Did you send those? It's important that you send those. Don't forget to send those. Hey, did you send that stuff? And when the client in the response clicks, yes, I sent it. Great. It automatically updates their status to in dispute. We wait 5 days. We send them an email. We wait 15 days, we send them an email, we set a task to call, we wait 10 days, we send them an email that says, you know, start checking your mail. We wait 5 days after that, it automatically changes their status from in dispute to set for review. When it changes to set for review, it automatically sets a task for the reviewer to do the file review. When that task is marked as complete, it sends it to billing. When that part's done, it sends back to sent to processing, and it cycles over and over and over. I know that was a lot and a little. Right? But all they do is finish their tasks. Right? All they do is finish their tasks. And if they finish their tasks, like, guys, I'm not saying that you don't have your one-off things where something crazy happens. But if you finish your, if you set it up task-based and the people finish their tasks, that means everything's good. If the tasks are done, everything's good. So if you want to know what's going on, just go look at the task list and go, hey, I notice your tasks aren't done. And the person says, yeah, I know this excuse or whatever. And either it's a good enough one or a bad enough one. And you go, nope, that doesn't cut it. Get the task done. Or you go, oh, I'm very sorry to hear that. You know, I wish you the best. Why don't you take a day, but come back tomorrow and let's get these tasks done. That's really your only two options, right? Either it's a good enough excuse or it's not a good enough excuse. Sometimes you gotta fire people. So here's what I do. Here's what I do. Here's what I do. I hired Karen. And sometimes I say, hey, fire that person. Because I cannot do it. Have I ever actually fired anybody?
Yeah, the one that didn't
show up on the
second
day. Oh, yeah.
She quit.
Yeah, she quit. Didn't show up. Technically, she quit.
You just told her not to come back.
Right.
She told herself. She fired herself.
So, additionally, these note templates, you can set them to, you know, add tags. You can set them to, you know, you can make the note, you can make just adding that note do anything else in the system. I know this is overwhelming. I really do. It took me months to really grasp this inside of when I first started doing it inside of Infusionsoft. And guys, I consider myself a moderately intelligent. Like, I get this kind of stuff, and it still took me a long time to really wrap my head around it. So, when it clicks and when you get it and you realize I can run my whole business through here, and like, guys, if I didn't have my automation, I would have a staff 3 or 4 times the size that I have right now. And that's not an exaggeration at all. When we went full automation, we cut our workloads in half and doubled our revenues. And that's real life. So it's where it's at. All right. You can make a task viewable by the client or the partner. So if you know their partner logs in and they're viewing that person, they can view the notes, or you can set a note that they can't view. You can also set a note that the partner can view that the client doesn't see. Like, hey Jeff, your guy's a moron, right? That's the referral partner or affiliate, right? So you can set it to where the partner can see it, but the client cannot.
I wouldn't risk it. You either made a mistake and clicked on the wrong thing.
Yep.
If the client see it, I wouldn't even risk it.
Yep.
Just send them a text, huh?
Yeah. So you can also flag the note automatically. Remember when I showed you guys flagging it and it just added, you know, just turned red? Guys, on notes, if you flag a note, all it does is it puts a little flag out beside it. All it does, it just puts a little flag. It doesn't do anything else. It just makes it to where you can see, oh, this is something important. I flagged this for a reason. I need to maybe check up on it. No. You can also add tags from right here, right? You say, every time I add this note, I also want to add this tag. Right? Every time I add this note, I want to add this tag. So then, every time that I added that note template, it would go and add those tags to the client also. And then when we get through campaign, I promise you guys are going to be, tags will be like your bestest friend. You're going to love the tags.
I tried. Yep. I kind of got it.
Yep. That's why I'm here. You'll get it. That's what we're here for, guys. You guys will, like, I promise you'll leave with a better understanding of this whole thing. I promise you.
If not, I'm staying.
Yeah?
I'm moving in with you.
Well, you can probably room apparently with Katie, because she's already told me that I'm booked on Thursday.
Are we here until we're
ready? Right? So, this is the first Red Bull I've had in.
Are you?
Do you have wings?
5 or 6 months.
Good job. I would like to get to that point.
Yeah. I've had one.
I don't need that. I have one.
Mm-hmm. All right, guys. What I want to do, no joke, I kind of and you don't have to. I'm just gonna stand up and take just a second, kind of stretch. Lunch killed us all. What?
You might need action. You
have to get out of line. And I'm gonna take a look at what this issue is.
Good day. The clients that I had on month before, I kept them on month until they canceled or whatever. I thought, hybrid is where you do the initial accident, but you split the finance. So, for example, like I had a client that had $900 invoice.
Yeah, it's hot now. Well, that's because they kicked it way up.
We charge $100 for public records.
Kills me to drive through there.
If you go from Chattanooga over to North Carolina, that area right there is even that's beautiful.
All right, are you guys ready? Oh, by the way, also tomorrow, I will be in a t-shirt and jeans. Yeah. I do like your Jimmy. For the recording, she is wearing a shirt with Jimi Hendrix on it. Alrighty, let's kick back at this. So that's notes, guys. Any real questions on notes? Notes, you can have as many templates as you want. You make them in admin, campaign, notes, and you can add a new template or a new category. So like if we, right now we've got client notes. What if we also wanted to have some that were for lead, you know, save? So now we've got two categories. So if I'm creating a template, another one, and I go, this is a lead something or other, lead note, I can put it into the lead note category. Simple?
Yeah. So my question is, notes is used for like your client and for like your employees?
Well, notes will show on the portal of anything. So notes can have states of the note exists no matter what. It can also be included as on the client portal and on the referral partner portal. The idea behind that is it's not that the note, it's not like there's three versions of the note. The note just hits, it sits on the database as one. But if it's true to show on client, it'll also show up on the client portal. If it's true for affiliate or partner, it'll show up on their portal as well. Notes are for like they called, you called them, something happened on the file. Like, it's notes. Tags are, the best way that I tend, they're more descriptive. Yes, exactly. They're more descriptive. So if I had a stack of sticky notes in my hand, I would I would tag, okay, female, tag male, tag female, right? Something that I would tag. And then I would be like, okay, brown hair, okay, there's a red hair, there's blonde hair, okay, blue eyes, brown eyes, right? That would be something that I could tag about us as a group. Long sleeves, short sleeves, right? The more you can tag a person, the better you can segment your database, the better you can segment your audience. And when you can segment your audience, you can sell the right people the right things. If you're selling the wrong people things, then you're automatically selling them the wrong thing, right? I don't want to market my business credit service to a person that has no real income and doesn't own a business. Like, it's just like, why am I doing that? Because what I'm doing is I would have a better product for that person, but instead I'm watering down their view of me. Because they're like, this guy just tries to sell me everything he has. He's not trying to sell me what's right for me. He's just trying to sell me all of his crap. So instead, sell the people that fit for that product, and don't sell it to the people that don't. Cool? Yeah.
You made a really good point. When I first started building mine out, I did a lot of my stuff. My sequences started by statuses, which is all wrong, because if I had somebody in round one status, but then their credit monitoring failed, so I changed them to failed credit monitoring,
yeah.
It completely wiped out the round one campaign that I was rolling. So then it had to start everything over. So
tags.
Yeah, so tags is the best way to
tag.
And that kind of made it more sense to me, like, okay, I had to go through that problem to find out. So, you know, they stayed in round one, but I tagged them that their credit monitoring failed. So they still went to the campaign, and for instance, you know, they got me the information back within, you know, a week or so, that, and then they were able to stay in that campaign and keep going. But yeah, I had to learn that the hard way.
Statuses is really not the best way. When you get into it for most purposes, statuses is usually not the best way to start a sequence. It can be used, but I use tags almost every single time. I use tags. All right. So we'll get there. We'll get to sequences, I promise. Well, that's going to be most of tomorrow.
Yeah.
Like tomorrow is going to be, you know, statuses and creating some sequences and creating some. It's going to be still a little bit of show and tell where it's more me doing it. And then we'll get to tomorrow where you can where it's you're building along with. And then Wednesday is going to be more like in little groups. And we're going to go through creating ideas for sequences and, stuff like that. All right. So that's how you add note templates. All right, so after notes is items. Items are separated by item type, original creditors, collections, public records, inquiries, names, socials, dates of birth, incorrect address. Items are searchable, so you can go find an item if you're looking for it, right? On your main item list, it just shows like the item name, the furniture, and the item type. Find you a full one. Here you go. Experian collection. Here's the number. Here's the furniture and what type of item it is. That's all it shows. Why? Well, you know what? Normally, that's all we really need to find the right item. Sometimes you need to see more and you click and open up the details. And that's when you've got your full details. But you don't have to be looking at that. Now, another difference is notes. You have item-specific notes. A lot of you guys, I know... Katie does, I know Donna and Michelle, they do a lot of stuff that's really specific to an individual item. It's not so much just disputing, but it's like, you know, different violations exist and they're moving this over to attorneys and they're, you know, different things. You can add notes that are specific to this item. Make sense? Okay. You can generate a specific letter from the item. Dispute sequence is coming soon where you'll be able to actually set up a sequence of letters to happen on certain dates. And then the item activity is change the status. Every time something happens, change the balance, change anything.
Eric, that dispute sequence when it comes out, is that going to be relating that one item only, right?
This one item.
So is that going to be like instructions? I mean, what would it be?
The difference is right now, you're in your sequences, you're really only able to create bureau letters.
Right.
Here, you'll be able to create a sequence for that creditor letters.
Okay.
Yeah, it's really difficult to do that in the sequencer because which item?
Right. Gotcha. Okay.
Explain that again.
The dispute sequence would be so you can create a sequence of letters to the original credit, to the collection agency, not to the bureau letters. It'll be to
right.
the original creditor, right?
Yeah.
Or the collection agency or the courthouse or whatever. So you can schedule that.
Yep. All right. The internal notes are for, whoops. I think I took it off. I don't remember. Yeah, I don't remember. That's a really great question. That's been so long ago. I don't even remember what I was doing that for, the internal notes for items.
Could be like a specific, if you have an account with late payments on it, and you want to know when those late payments were, how do you keep track of the late payments? Kind of
thing. Yeah. I don't know. I don't know if it just, I don't know. Add a note into it and see if it just shows up in the notes. How you add an item is you click add item, you select the type. Original creditor item drops down. Now, guys, I've heard, it needs to be able, it doesn't. Okay. I don't know what that does. I'll tell you what it probably does. Probably gets taken off. Would we prefer, let's just tell her to just, when on add item, just take off internal notes.
Or can you just make that the same as the other notes? So that way.
To an initial, we could, actually, yeah, that whatever goes into the internal note box when you're adding an item, it just needs to add as the first note for that item. Okay.
Are you talking about the items now?
I'm talking about items right now.
Okay. When you, I'm going to go do round two.
Okay.
And I'm going to add new instructions.
Okay.
If you have any items on there and you mark one of them as deleted and leave the other two as negative, when you click to edit the item so you can edit the instructions and then you click save, it takes away the mark of deleted from the item. So then you have to go back and mark the item as deleted again, and that generates another charge for that item. So it's not saving the deleted status, I guess, of that item when you go back into it.
Oh.
You can do it how you seal.
No, I don't show that. Yeah, we don't use instructions, so I wouldn't have even thought about that. Yep, I'll fix that.
Because it happens to me every single time I do it, and then I have to go back to the invoice and remove that charge or credit it, and then it just screws up the entire bill.
Yeah, I imagine. That definitely shouldn't work that way. I don't use any instructions. Okay.
Sorry.
That's all right. On the items, if you edit an item, it doesn't offer. It takes away the deleted status. So if an item has been deleted, and then you edit the item and click save, it takes the deleted off.
Or repaired, or whatever.
Or right.
Yeah.
Treats it as if it's a new item being added in there again.
Yep. So what I'll do is this, instead of being negative or positive, this will just be a drop down that includes all of the current statuses.
Yeah.
And then it will pre-fill with whatever it currently is, and it'll only change if you change it.
Yeah, that'll be perfect.
Yep. Yes. No, no, no. It's not going to go away. That box will just add whatever you type in here. It will add it as the first note on the item.
Okay, because I know the other note, you said you can see those in the portal.
But you have to click it.
I just wanted to make sure that, because I do think that's an important box, that internal note, because when you're auditing or when you're going through the credit file and you're adding items, sometimes it can be things about the file that you really want to make sure that you wrote down. So don't get rid of it.
We're not getting rid of the box. It's okay. Just that it'll show as, it'll like add it on the notes.
Okay.
Yeah.
It won't show in the portal. It's just internal. That's how I look at it. I know somebody asked what was the point of the internal notes.
I didn't remember what the point of the internal notes was.
Okay. I was just saying my understanding to see if that was correct.
Right.
Because I didn't realize.
What you said, it's okay. What you're asking for something. You're asking for one thing. Other people have asked for something else. So, Nope, she didn't. She doesn't want it to show in the notes because notes are viewable in the portal by the client. And she wants that to not be viewable. Because
it says internal, so it's like company information just for our student purposes.
I understand. Yep.
You know, you're taking notes about that specific account.
Don't you have to mark the others who can see it?
Yep.
So what would make that one different where it just would default to me who can see it?
I'm just going to put... the two check boxes right below that.
Oh, yeah. That'll work.
Yep.
So they could if you wanted them to, but it'll default to they can't.
It'll default to they can't. Okay. But you can view it. You can add. You can just check the two boxes if you want it to be a note that's viewable.
That works. Got it.
Got it.
Okay, so basically what you're saying is that anytime we add a note, and for each note, we have to put client in order for them.
No. When you're adding an item, there's this box that says internal notes up here. When right below that, it'll say viewable by client or partner. If you don't click either, it'll add the note, but it's only viewable by you. If you click client, but that's like just if you have something for that item. Probably significantly fewer of the items will have notes, internal notes like that than don't. Normally, it's the same old crap that we see over and over and over. But every now and then, you've got that weird item that you want to make a note about. You can then click, okay, I want the client to see that, or the partner, or both. Or neither. So all I need is the viewable by, and I need that to go under the notes with the viewable by. Yep. So when you're adding an item, guys, one thing that a lot of people have asked me is, well, Eric, you're only putting the information in once. What if the account number is different? Or what if whatever? Any of these green, see how they're clickable? Like account number? If I click account number, it opens that up and I can put Equifax, Experian, and TransUnion account numbers different.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Right? Katie didn't know that either.
Because sometimes they are slightly different.
Right?
It might be the last four, then the other one would be like the last.
The idea behind it is more often they're the same, right? More of the fields are the same than different. So if you have to do it, if it's set to be different, then that means you have to put it in and then you have to click copy over and then copy over or whatever. With this one, you only have to open up the ones that are different. So I could go item name, furniture, Chase, USA, type is whatever. Account number is different, so I go click and I go, here's that account number, and here's this account number. It's different on that bureau, and then here's this account number.
By the way, welcome to the Disco Accelerator, right?
It's coming from there.
Yeah, I'm playing it for some reason.
So,
and
I totally kind of ripped off the name from the Infusionsoft.
Hold on.
It just doesn't make so much sense, right? It's just...
Why am I playing it?
This is how you move forward.
You look at you like you want to do it.
I've used my business for several years now.
Right?
Like around 8 years, actually, got started.
Right.
So I've been doing this around the same time, way back when. We were some of the first early adopters of.
But it's not playing.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, I was taking down there. Press pause.
Are you still recording?
I am still recording. All right, I stopped it. That's weird. It just randomly started playing.
So you be hanging out with Casper?
Yeah. Yep. What's wrong with my desktop? Here, hold on. I'll clean it up. I don't use the icons on my desktop. I'm a Finder guy, so I click here. This? You know, so I have a lot of friends who are comedians. And when a comedian has something tragic happen, we laugh, right? Not at each other, but to and with each other. Because that's how we cope, right? One of my friends, who's a comedian, very dear friend, beautiful girl, had a ovarian cyst, right? And they removed it, and just for the fun of it, she posted a picture, and we all started posting, like, about what it looked like, and, like, giving it names, and, like, just making fun of the situation, because it's either laugh or cry, and we just choose laugh. So, in love, right? Like, with love. So it really looked a lot like, this is the Amazing World of Gumball. It's a show. It was shaped exactly like this. So that's just, I found that picture and I posted it under there. It's the Amazing World of Gumball. So that's that. Yeah.
Thanks for sharing.
You bet. So that's where we live, though. It's just you either laugh or cry, and that's, we choose laugh. Nope. I want Chrome. So we added an item. Come through here. Item description, you guys. Has everybody loaded up all of the item descriptions yet? Great. Yeah. I'll make sure that everybody, I will just load everybody's item descriptions up. So that you don't even have to. What do you think?
Yeah, I think you're awesome.
Okay.
And amazing.
Guys, we spent like a long time writing all these item descriptions. And by we, I really mean mostly Stephanie. I would do some and then she would take it and run with it. But the item descriptions are the ability to tell your client a little something about each item. So if I go public record, bankruptcy, Chapter 11, discharged or filed, and currently active. Well, by going down that, I just wrote that paragraph. Your file shows a currently active Chapter 11 bankruptcy file. While we're excited to help you, we need to know if this file is in fact currently active. If it is, we recommend waiting until the BK has been discharged before we would want to move forward with working on that item. Right? So you can edit those as you see fit for your company, or you can leave them. Yep, generic. Yeah. There are hundreds of them. So to give you an idea, public record, bankruptcy, judgment, tax lien. If they go bankruptcy, it's other, and then it's dismissed, filed, discharged. If they go dismissed, it's more than 5 years, less than 2 years, 2 to 5 years. So how old? Well, it's less than 2 years old. So just bankruptcy, other, dismissed, there's three. And then filed, there's two. And discharged, there's three. And then you go chapter 13, filed, there's two. Discharged, there's three. Guys, there's hundreds of these things. And we've not left judgment or tax lien or installment, auto, educational, recreational, child. And then if you click on it, right, collection, return check, child support, credit card, paid or unpaid, how long ago, revolving, let's say unsecured, closed or open, it's open. Positive or negative? It's negative. It's 90 to 1, right? You get it? There's like 600 different ones. And so you're welcome. Right? But it creates that paragraph. Guys, that is a huge value add for customers. They're looking at it and actually having the ability to know an idea about every single item on their file. And it doesn't, here's how much extra work it costs. You ready? You're putting in the item and you go, well, this was a public record, bankruptcy, 11, filed, currently active. That's how much extra work it took. 2 or 3 seconds. And it's the ability to really add a huge amount of value. Include in utilization ratio. This is a yes or no. If you check yes, then that means that item's balance and limit will be included in the utilization ratio moving forward. Right? Instructions. You can also spin out instructions in your list. So if I go to admin, system, item dropdowns, instructions. Okay, so here's all these instructions that I can do. And then I can go, I want to add a new instruction. Now, there should be that spinner button right there. This, save, spin it. So, item, comma, account, comma, trade line, comma, what else, what, like this account, this item, this file, right? And then we go add, and then I want to go is, well, actually I'd probably just type it here, is incorrect, inaccurate, not right, wrong, false, ad spinner.
BS.
Yeah. Complete and utter crap. So anytime I use that instruction, it will randomly select. So that instruction might read, this item is incorrect. It also might read, this account is wrong, or this trade line is false, right? It randomly selects this part, and it randomly selects that part, and you can do that as many times as you want. So if you're doing something where you're just doing like the, can you please verify the, watch this. This is going to be good. Any other field, like I could just list any field that I wanted, right? I could just list field after field after field after field. And then I go add spinner of this account is correct. So now I could use that same instruction on a, you know, if you're just at that point where you're like, hey, can you verify the balance? Hey, can you verify the whatever, can you verify the whatever? Can you verify this? Can you verify that? Data loss activity, can you verify this? I could actually use the exact same instruction over and over and over, and each time it would just randomly select a different reason to dispute it.
The instruction tab is used for creating your template letter.
Yes, so you can give an item, you can select an item, an instruction. And then when you're creating your template letters, you can do one of two things. You can do item list, or you can do item list with instructions. So if you select with instructions, it'll say the item name, and then it'll say the item account number, and then it would have a little dash, and it would say the instruction of what you want done on that item. Right? It's your instruction to the bureau. Cool? And then These buttons down here decide where you want that to show up. So if I click incorrect address, and then I unclick incorrect address from all the rest of those, you see incorrect address is the only one where that one is selected, right? So if I go to, they save. All right, so if I go to clients, ignore that. What now? Did we lose our, does everybody have internet? Okay, I just lost mine for a second. I was about to be super pissed. So if I go back and I want to add an item and I want to add an incorrect address, when I go to instructions, there's the spinners that are available.
Oh, okay.
Right?
So you're instructing the processor on how to dispute.
Nope. This goes right on the letter to the bureau.
Oh, okay.
All right. Does anybody have questions on adding items that do not include uploading a credit report? Yes.
I was trying to add an item in the other day, and because it wasn't saved in the system, I was trying to add it, but on the report, it didn't have the address. It was one of those that didn't mm-hmm. have everything, and it was kind of requiring it, so I had to put, like, fake information in just to get it to save it.
You had to... Did you put in a ticket?
No.
Okay. I would start there.
Okay.
I would put in a ticket. Especially put in a ticket right now because stuff's, you know, like Maria's trying to get stuff going as we go.
I didn't know if you had said it that way.
It does require certain information. It requires a furnisher.
Yeah, and there was no furnisher. Not on the credit report, not in the details at the end.
So we need to create a furnisher called No Furnisher Listed. Done. Yep, we'll just create a furnisher called No Furnisher.
Okay.
And then that way it'll have no address.
Okay. Yeah, because it was illegitimate. I didn't want to put fake information in because I didn't want to.
Right.
Okay.
When you print a letter, is it okay if part of that letter gets printed with the ID documents? Or does it have to, the ID documents have to be separate from the letter?
I don't think it matters at all.
But sometimes what happens is it goes to two pages because you have such a long list of items.
Mm-hmm.
And then the second page is, it goes to the...
The first ID doc and then the second ID doc?
So it's okay if it's...
I mean, you're still including ID with the letter.
Sometimes it'll be like the last two lines of the address will be what the ID documents and it drives me nuts.
Do you preview? You know you can preview before you.
Right, but you can. But then if that's the case, then you have to go to the templates and you have to rearrange the space.
No, you can change that, just that letter.
For that one letter?
Mm-hmm.
In templates?
No, right there when you're doing it.
When you're editing. When you're in that preview.
Yeah, so when you're in letters... And you go letter creator, and you go, you know, next. This person obviously has no items, which that would be awesome if they did. Yeah, that person doesn't have any items.
When it prints like that is what I'm saying.
Right. No. I understand. I totally understand. I'm saying that when right before you clicked save, you have the option that says preview edit.
Okay.
And if you edit it, you're not actually editing that template. You're only editing that that letter.
This actual one.
This actual letter. So you can see kind of what it's going to look like. Mm-hmm. And then Karen, what she does, because she hates that too. But what she'll do is she'll like take out a line or a space somewhere mm-hmm. and get it to kick up.
Right. But that's what I've been doing. But I go back to the templates and I do it on templates and save it.
No, you can do it just one off on each letter if you want.
Tell me when it does it in half. The ID in half.
We fixed that one, right?
Yeah, you fixed that one.
Yeah, it should. It doesn't list it in half anymore.
Okay, so you can go
through that. All righty.
customer wasn't late and chose late, can you add that to that category?
Yeah. You can add anything you want. Anything that you want, you can add to that. Yep.
So it's right at that page where you put include ID docs and open now. Right there it says preview edit.
Yep.
Okay, I see it.
Yep. And you can edit just that. And you preview it, take a look at what it's going to look like when it prints, and then if it doesn't look right.
This screen, you go here. Okay, cool. And then you can. But.
All right. Are we ready?
See,
we're gonna build this stuff and practice it this later, right?
Just trying to get through it.
Change the spacing.
That's all right. Okay, guys, we're gonna go through the practice of all this. Let me hug and then a slap a little bit. If you guys are constantly working along, I promise you're missing what's happening. Right? You're just missing. We're doing it on kind of on purpose this way of like watch, then watch it happen, then do, right? And it'll go a lot smoother. So here is your from letters to audit review. Audit and review, guys, you have to set them up beforehand in order to use them. She's right back there. I'd like a pill. Can you bring me one? Thank you. Can I have? Yeah.
One of those genius pills, like limitless.
Yeah.
Right. What happens to Bert similar to that?
For him, he does.
Because you guys have me, I'm just lost.
Yeah.
Okie doke. See you on the other side. All right. Thank you. Okay. So the audit and review, you have to set those up. If you don't set up the audit or the review process, then it's going to look all bleh. That's it, right? When you're setting up your audit and review, it's just what do you want to tell people? What do you want them to hear from you in your audit? That happens in admin audit review. Here's where you set all that stuff up. Are we squished kind of looking again? No? Okay. Anyway, so I'm in here with the audit. In the audit, I've got different sections. For one, I've got different versions of the audit. One, audit two, audit three. Here's where you can edit your audit tree if you decide to. You can do that right there, right? You can do conclusions. We'll talk about what conclusions are. And then you can do your review. When we're talking about the audit text one, there's sections. This is your full text. Then you have a good way to think about it. This is the book. These are the chapters. Did that make sense? Oh, it felt good for me when I said it.
Yeah.
Right? The chapters are in the book. But I come over here and I write my introduction. Dear client first name. Now to use those things, I can come over here and click. I can spin inside if I want to. I can spin to where maybe everybody's audit isn't exactly the same. I can do that. I've got the variables alongside here, client first name, client middle name, client last name, client email, auditor's first and last name, and the auditor's email, the monitoring site that was used, the score model of that site, the score model description. So you guys have clients all the time that go, well, that's not my scores though, because my bank said, or that's not my score because blah, blah, blah. When you're creating these monitoring sites, which you can add to, I think you guys already have some in there. But when you're creating those, you can say, this monitoring service uses the Credit Expert Score Model. The Credit Expert Score Model breaks down like this. You might notice it'll be different from what you receive at your bank. This is because, and right, you can write the score model description. It's just going back to making sure your client knows what's going on. If they know what's going on and they feel like that you are empowering them with not just some service but also knowledge, then they're happy, right? Like they got something from you. People view that knowledge far higher than they view a deletion. They're really much more proud and they're much more excited by the knowledge that they gain along the way. Right? So you can do report date, Equifax score, the different scores. You can do the Equifax inquiry numbers, the Equifax how many names they, you know, extra names, how many extra misspellings, the AKAs they had, the year of birth, the additional addresses, the Equifax grade, all of that stuff. Now, when we get down here to Equifax grade and Equifax grade description, Experian grade description, what those are is going through the audit process, you're going to select a grade. It is arbitrary. You're just assigning them a grade. Don't be scared to give Fs, right? Don't try to, you're not going to hurt anybody's feeling. If they've got a 440 credit score, you know you got an F, right? Don't sugarcoat it. Now, we do, our score description looks something like this. The score I gave you of F might actually look worse than it actually is. It's just an understanding of the likelihood that you would be issued new credit at this point. We feel that likelihood would be very small, which is why we don't recommend applying for any new credit at this time. Right? However, many of our clients, after just, you know, a few rounds of service, have seen their grades increase greatly. Right? You're done. Did I hurt anybody's feelings right then? No. They know they want. There's a really great book called Tribes. I've read 3 books, I think, ever. And one of them.
I don't believe it.
One of them was a book called Tribes. It was given to me by a really good friend. And then I read it and I gave it to somebody else. Because that's what you should do with a really good book. Did you know that? You should always give your really best books to somebody else. So I read this great book, and one of the premises of the book was that people inherently want to be led, right? They want to be part of a tribe. They want to be part of a group that's bigger than them. How many of you guys really enjoy being on, like, the disco group and the credit nerds group and stuff, right? You really enjoy that because you have multiple roles that everybody gets to play. They get to play the role of both student and coach sometimes, right? Like, now, it's a little different when we're coaching each other because there's not quite as much. Most of us know a lot of the same things. But you still get that feeling of that togetherness and that group. And did we enjoy lunch? Lunch was great, right? Right? Sitting with a bunch of like-minded people that you got to talk about the stuff that matters to you and it also matters to them. People want to be led. They want to be a part of something. And when you are actually training your customer along the way, the majority of them will really appreciate that. And they feel like they become part of it. Guys, we have people that wear like Credit Nerds t-shirts that are like, they're like, yeah, you know, they're part of. I had somebody dress up as me for Halloween. That's true. That I posted, I have officially made it. Somebody dressed up as me for Halloween. But like when they're part of, you know, I don't ever want to jinx, right? Because I don't want to be that guy that's like, we don't get complaints. But guys, we don't get a lot of complaints. We just don't, right? I've got one negative review online, and it's not about my company. It's about another company. We've had one BBB complaint ever in 8 years, and we've had 2 attorney general complaints ever in 8 years, and all 3 of them were dropped. I asked the first ever attorney general complaint. I was asked to give a refund, which I did, and he really was like, can you give me a refund so that I can get this woman out of here because she's driving me crazy. And I did. The second one, I wasn't asked to give a refund to. He goes, nope, she owed every bit of that money. And then the BBB complaint, we've had one BBB complaint, and we still have an A-plus rating that we didn't buy or pay for or argue about. They gave us an A-plus rating. I argued a little bit. I did call them racist. I did. I said, this was way back when, because they wouldn't issue me a rating. They wouldn't issue me one.
Unless you pay.
Unless I paid. And I was like, I'm not paying. And I was like, and they said, well, we don't issue grades to people in your industry because, you know, we've seen how other people in the industry act. And then I was like, that is basically the definition of racism. You just assigned a you just assigned something to me because of something you saw once. And I'm like, or sexism or ageism or anything else. I was like, you have no idea. You don't know. I said, you don't know me. That's what I told him. I said. But I was like, you don't.
He went
in the deal. I did. I was like, this is literally the it's illegal. If I was a person and not a business, it's illegal. But because I'm a business, you're treating me this way. And I was like, so I'm not paying for your rating system and I still expect a rating. And they did, which I thought I had basically just talked myself into an F, but they issued us a rating. They went and actually looked at our they did an advertising review, which they didn't believe because they were like, says here that you've been published in USA Today. And I was like, I was. And I just had to send them over an article showing that I had been published in USA Today and like that I was, you know, served as expert witness and all of those things that it says. They wanted proof of everything and we sent it all to them. Now we've got an A+ rating. But the reason that we do all that stuff is because we make our customers feel like they're really part. And the vast majority of it's automated. The vast majority of it is doing things like this where we explain to them what that grade means. We explain to them what that, when it shows what the, it says the TransUnion grade description, the grade I gave you of C is actually better than you might think. When you think about a C, remember, that's average. Right now, you've got a pretty average credit profile. Nothing to be ashamed of. Now, it would be great if we could bump that up to a B or an A, right? And that stuff comes across to them as a way of, like they feel like, okay, cool. It's not built to make them feel bashed. But at the same time, you have to be honest with them because nobody wants a yes man, especially nobody wants a yes man as a financial services provider. And although, you know, we try to stay out of that realm of financial services providers, in their eyes, we are a provider of one of their financial services. A lot of these people look at us the same way that they look at their CPA, the same way that they look at, you know, their investment advisors. They look at us with some of those same thoughts, right? So be that for them. If you're just yesing them, then you're not really helping them. So give them the grade. Tell them what that grade really means. The utilization, this one is just a number. Any number, any item that you selected as include in utilization, it's going to look at the balance and limit and give them a percentage on that bureau.
Are these all like chapters in this letter that you?
No. My apologies. These are variables. So if I was to come right here and I clicked Equifax score, it would just insert a number right there. That's all it would do. It's just insert a number. If I put in Equifax inquiry, it would insert the number of inquiries. And as we go through the audit builder, like when we're creating an audit, you'll see because it's asking yes or no and fill in the blank questions. These are the answers to those yes or no and fill in the blank questions. So you come over here to the audit information. Guys, here's your item table, a conclusion list. yeah, let's make it two.
It's going to be a long day. It's almost over.
I have cash.
No, I
never have
cash. I know. I think that'll cover
it. All right. So, conclusions are pretty awesome, right? Conclusions are lists that you can create of the stuff that you tell clients over and over and over and over, right? We can just ramble them off. Utilization ratio is too high. You have no open credit cards, right? You have student loan problems. You know, I noticed you had some student loans. You've got tax issues, right? You have too many store cards. You have way too many inquiries, right? That's right. So what you do is you write, you click add new conclusion. And I think I might have timed myself out. Nope, there it goes. When I click add new conclusion, all I have to do, guys, I give it a title called utilization too high. Do I want it to be available on the audit, the file review, or both? I want to be on both. We noticed that your utilization ratio is too high, period. You will remember from the education section that utilization ratio is a large factor in your credit score, period. We recommend keeping this at a maximum of no more than 30%, period. Right? And you're writing this paragraph out to them. We can't stress this enough. Exclamation point.
Do you ever write all caps like that?
Knock it off.
Pay it down.
Save. Okay, so now we've got a conclusion here. Let's go ahead. We're going to click add new conclusion. Get rid of this. Are you guys feeling like our internet's running slower? No?
Right, I'm just like...
Yeah. We're not working on it.
All right. So we're going to do conclusion two. This is conclusion two. Audit and file review. Save. So now there's two of them, right? Now when I go to a client and I'm going to run an audit, we're going to go to J. Marie. I'm going to run an audit. The button is right here. Thank you. I'm going to be so sick.
Yes.
Yeah? Your Honor, counsel would like a bathroom break. Do you guys know what movie that is?
Liar, liar.
Liar, liar. This is why you're all my people, right? Oh, that was good. That was good. So let's finish this audit right quick, and then we will take a quick break. So if I'm going to run an audit, all I do is I click Run Audit. Drops down. It's going to ask me which version would I like to use, right? Version 1 I've used 5 times. Version 2 I've used 0 times. Version 3. Guys, one cool thing about that is you could have somebody put... Now, the variables are always going to be in English at this point. But you could have somebody write out, or you could write out your audit in Spanish or whatever, right? If you have Spanish-speaking clients, you could have somebody put an audit in Spanish. And you could come down and say, version 3, Spanish version, click. And it would send it to them in Spanish. We're not doing that, right? But you can do that. So I'm going to click that I want to use version 1. Continue. Now, report date. Guys, it's going to default to today. Because more often than not, you get the report and you do the audit, right? So it defaults to the current day. Report source. Where did I get this? Well, I got it from ScoreSense. Okay, what were the scores? Let's say that those were the scores. How many inquiries did they have on Equifax?
7.
Experian?
3.
TransUnion?
29.
Right. Next. The client's name is J. Marie Lynette Galeos. Is the client's name showing properly? Yes. Okay, if you click yes, nothing happens. If you click no, it says, okay, it's accurate on Equifax and accurate on Experian, but it's inaccurate on TransUnion. right? Okay, are there any misspellings of the name?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, how many?
Zero. Two.
Two. All right, are there any AKAs?
Yes.
Yes, how many?
One.
One on all three.
Oh, yeah.
Right? Is the client's year of birth listed on their registration as 1998 correct on all three bureaus? Yes. Is the client current address this correct? Yes, it is. Are there any additional addresses? Yep. There's two on each bureau of additional addresses. Next. Guys, you just made a whole paragraph about their personal info section that actually feels like you typed it out to them. We noticed on your file that you have two this, two that, one of this. Also notice that, blah, blah, all of it. Right? So now you've got their item list. Shows their scores, their total number of inquiries, positive, 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 not reported, negative there, right? Because you would have already put in the items at this point. Yeah. Right? So you scroll through here. Down at the bottom, utilization ratio, 100%, 100%, 100%. Look at all these negatives. What is this person's grade?
Yeah.
They got an F. Right? F, F, and F. Next. The consumer's report was of average layout with no uncommon characteristics. The reported scores were listed as 678, 704, and 679. It is not uncommon to see a large difference. So what it does is it looks to see if there's a difference of, like, I don't remember how many points. But if there's more than, like, 30 points, it says it's not uncommon to see a large difference. If the scores are close together, it says, although these scores are quite similar, it's not uncommon to see a large difference. One of the questions that you get along the way is, well, why is that one so high? Right? Or why is that one so low? So it's not uncommon to see a large difference between the listed scores. The score on each bureau is generated using only the information reporting on that particular bureau. Many items on the report are not reporting on all three credit bureaus. Cool? Now, this is fully editable for any strange situation, period. So if you have a situation that's different than normal, maybe they did have an uncommon characteristic. Maybe their entire Equifax score or their entire Equifax report had been wiped, right? Well, they had no positives or negatives on Equifax. That's a pretty uncommon characteristic. It's a little bit common for us, but it's uncommon in the world. So we can come in here and say, the consumer's report was of average layout. However, comma, we did notice that blah, 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 blah. Cool? You click next. Then, remember those conclusions we just typed? They will list right here along the side. Remember utilization ratio too high? Click, and it goes right there. Remember conclusion two? Click, goes right there. I like to put a space between them.
The title of the conclusion goes on there too?
The title of the conclusion goes on also. So keep that in mind when you...
Yeah.
Stupid idiots. Yeah. So, like, we do, like, some of our conclusions are you have student loans. Guys, this is a really great way to also cross-sell. We noticed you had some student loans. If you're interested in consolidating those, or if you're interested in finding out if you can get a lower payment, if you're interested in some help, we also offer that service. Now, the great thing, did I just ram something down their throat that they didn't need or want? Did I oversell them? Right? Hey, I noticed that you had some student loans. If you want some help with that, we're here for you for that as well. Hey, I noticed you had some tax issues. You had some tax liens. We work closely with a company that can help you with that. If you'd like some more information, just let me know. You're not overselling them. One thing that I think that we do, I make almost, okay, I know a couple of you guys have been to a symposium and have seen me speak a few times, but I don't make hardly any of our money on credit repair. We make a lot of money on other services that are wrapped around credit repair. How many clients do more than I do, I've been doing this for 8 years. We do about 30 clients a month. Right? That's nothing. How many you guys do? A lot of you guys do 30 clients a month. Right? Just starting out, you're doing 30 clients a month. There's, you know, I know Katie and you guys do 700 or 800 a month. Right? Yeah. Yeah. So, but we do like 30 files a month, guys, of actual credit repair. But we wrap so many other things around it that we run a seven-figure business off of those 30 clients a month. By wrapping so many other things and properly selling them other things. Not cramming other things down their throat, but properly selling them. It's more about informing them of their options. And if you do a good job with one service and you offer another service that they need, what stops them? Nothing. The only thing that stops them is if they just absolutely truly don't have the money. That's it. So then you click finish. Now, we just created this audit. Right? We just created this. Dear J. Marie, first and foremost, we'd like to thank you for this opportunity to work on your file. Without our clients, our days would be horribly boring. So before we get started, I would like to take a second and introduce you to the team. Blah, blah, blah. I talk about the team. I talk about what's in a credit report, some education, right? Yada. I talk about all this stuff. Then I get down here. In this section, we're going to discuss the specifics of the credit report. This will help you get a better understanding of the total amounts and types of items that are factoring into your credit score. Here's your name. Here's your source, here's the scoring model, here's the description of that scoring model, here's the date of the audit, total positive lines, total negative lines, total possible cost, the general description. Remember how we edited that? However, we did notice that. Remember when we were just editing that? Goes right there. Your registration info listed your name as J. Marie, middle name. That was an error that used to exist where it would actually put the name middle name in there. That's since been fixed. When checked against the credit report, this name was shown to be accurate on Equifax, accurate on Experian, and inaccurate on TransUnion. There are 1 AKAs and 0 misspellings of your name on Equifax, 1 AKAs and 0 misspellings of your name on Experian, and 1 AKA and 2 misspellings of your name on TransUnion. Our recommendation is the attempted removal of all incorrect or former names. We compared your year of birth on your credit file to your registration records. When checked against the report, this year of birth is shown to be accurate on Equifax, accurate on Experian, and accurate on TransUnion. The recommendation is to make sure all information is reported correctly. The report shows 7 inquiries on Equifax, the report shows 3 inquiries on Experian, and the report shows 29 inquiries on TransUnion. Inquiries can have a negative impact, blah, 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 blah. You tell about the difference. Here's all the items that you have, right? You've only got a couple of these few positives up here, but almost everything's negative. Come down here. In this section, we'll discuss the options for you to create a better overall profile. Equifax F. I didn't put in the grade description. I forgot to put that in there. But it would then say, the grade I give you of F means this. Come down here. We notice that your utilization ratio is too high. Here's conclusion number 2. Thank you, your name and stuff. Guys, how much value did you just give that client?
A whole lot.
This is why on the groups and stuff, this is why I get a tiny bit... a little cranky over the difference between an audit and you guys having like a few minute phone call with somebody and being like, oh, well, I did the audit. No, that's a consultation, right? An audit is like a detailed, like, yeah, think about if an audit was like a 15 minute conversation with the IRS. Isn't that what an audit is?
No.
No.
Don't think so.
No. Right? You're going, let's like detailed, like line by line by line by, like that's an audit. So we're creating something that's coming soon. This is pretty high on the list, but not, you know, like I'm not trying to have it done tomorrow. We're going to create you guys a, like an initial consultation version of this to where you can bring it up. It'll be similar to kind of, you'll have 3. You'll have like an initial consultation, an audit, and a file review. So the initial consultation will be more of just a little yes and no's, how many items do they have, some stuff that you noticed. And then when you fill that all out, you click submit and it puts it available in their portal right then. So that's why leads have a portal. As you can say, you can actually go and log in and look at this, because when you engage that lead, there's a lot higher chance of them becoming, I really like your new haircut. Look really great.
Thank you.
Right? Looks really good. So when you engage that that client, or when you engage that lead, there's a lot higher likelihood that they later become a client, right? Okay. So there you go. That's an audit. That's running an audit. They have that when if I log out.
How did you get your signature on
that?
You uploaded
it? That's an image. Okay. I signed a piece of paper. I scanned it in. And then I cropped it to just that. And then I did a little bit of Photoshop to it where I popped the contrast where you couldn't see the grain of the paper. Mm-hmm. So it whited out the paper and darkened the signature.
On the Mac, it has an option. If you sign a piece of paper and hold it to the camera, it'll hold it.
Oh, will it? Yeah. That's cool. You should just get a Mac and you're done. I mean, that's really the answer anyway. So when a client logs in...
Right.
All right, you guys didn't see this. Oh, I need it.
Well, she was fixing the thing for her.
Oh, tell her I need it. I use the other one.
You're fine.
Yeah.
The audit, the invoices.
Oh, no, I'm not. I need it for the main one because she's set as a user, and I need to log in as a user, as a client. So what?
The audit, you can save it as a PDF, right, and send it to the client via email if you wanted to?
No.
You can't. It's only in the portal.
It's in the portal.
So you force it to log in.
Yes. You got it. You went with the exact understanding. Get them to the portal. The more they interact on the portal, the better it is for you and the better it is for me.
But that's the thing with the portal. If they're not, a lot of them are going to be doing it on their phone.
Right. We're working on it. Jeez Louise. I get it.
But how do you give them the audit?
They need to go to the library.
You tell them to get on the computer.
Right? You tell them to go get on one.
Because a lot of people have computers.
Or you charge them for a paper copy. You print it off and say you want a paper copy.
Yeah. Guys, I'll get at a bare minimum, we'll get the client side more to where it'll be fully mobile friendly. Yeah.
Ooh, wow, she is awesome.
Is she giving me that?
Is that
I sent it to her and then she said what, why, and she doesn't like that stuff, so I told her why and now I'm waiting.
Eric, tell her she can send it to me if she prefers.
Do we have the option of printing it out? The audit? I know it can only be used in
a portal. Well, I mean, you have the option. Anything that's on a page, you can click Control P. Print.
Eric, I have a question. I know we're talking about the mobile thing,
but the contract, the audit, everything that a client needs to do is a priority to make mobile compatible. Yep. Everything that a client has to do, top priority for mobile compatible. Oh, yeah. Let's take a break real quick, guys, and I'll get that from Maria so I can show you, the other side and what they see. I'm going to go ahead and stop this, and we will kick it back up. This is part 2.